So I think that the degree of staginess changes. So of course the national troops, although they're beautiful, they are many degrees away, if I can say, from the original source. Not to say they're less good, but I mean the degrees of like away from the real folklore. And are we is our goal to present real authentic folklore? How can we do that?
Welcome to Belly Dance Live podcast. My name is Iana Komarnytska. I'm a full-time dancer based in Toronto, performing a variety of Middle Eastern and Central Asian dance styles, including belly dance. You can find me at ianadance.com as well as on Insta or Facebook by Iana Dance or Iana Komarnytska. I'm happy you've decided to join us for this weekly dose of dance inspiration, because here on this podcast we explore all nuances and insights into lifestyle of ballet dancers, and we are having amazing star guests who share their stories, secrets and tips with you. Hello guys, welcome to Ballet Dance Live podcast and the new episode. I'm really thrilled to publish this conversation with beautiful Samantha Burnstein, and this is one of those rare episodes that I actually get to record in person. I had the pleasure of visiting Montreal 1 or 2 weeks ago, and for 2 days straight we just talked with Samantha non-stop about all kinds of and sorts of dance related topics. And at some point we just decided, okay, we need to record and put it on the podcast, because she has really cool insights into this world, and her experience is very interesting. And one of the fascinating things about her, at least to my point, was that she actually had a very successful ballet dance career at local dance scene, and at some point she decided to fully focus on just folklore styles. And right now, for a couple of years, she absolutely stopped doing any ballet dance performances or classes, and she's fully focused on just folklore, but not just whatever folklore, very specific and very unusual folklore of Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, some styles of Iraq, Khaliji, and some other styles. But those are those countries that are not that traditional to be taught in ballet dance class. So we talk a lot about her story of how she got involved into it and how she managed to be artist fully focused just on folklore styles without keep going in ballet dance, traditional ballet dance career, let's say, steps. And you will hear a little bit fun beginning of the conversation, just because it was a bit weird for us after keep talking for several few days. Now realize, oh, now we are recording and it will be published, so you'll hear a couple of weird laughs in the beginning. But I hope you'll enjoy the conversation. And also, just to add about Samantha, because I'm really fascinated about her input and her expertise in Middle Eastern and North African dances that she studied for the last 20 years. She also has a degree in cultural anthropology and conducts research in dance ethnology, and she has contributed to various academic and dance venues and publications. And this is also one of the topics that we talked on the podcast, how to think critically and analyze information. Is it really true, or should I maybe question this or research more, instead of just blindly following whatever your teacher or guest instructor says to you? So I think this is a really valuable insight. And also, she has a troupe which is fully focused just on performing folklore styles of those countries that she is specializing in. And they even performed in Dubai at one cultural festival at some point. So I'm really excited for you to listen to the interview. But before we dive right into this discussion, I want quickly also to thank you. I dig the to our iTunes statistics and analytics a few days ago, and I have discovered that we already have quite a few of 5-star ratings from you. Thank you so much. And even a couple of reviews, very lovely reviews from Noram123 as well as Zed Curry. So thank you so much, our dear listeners. I really appreciate, and your feedback and ratings and reviews really help to promote and push this podcast and make it happen. I know a lot of you listen on my website, but I also know that a lot of you listen directly from iTunes and Google Play. So if you are one of those people, please take a few seconds and go to the app and just leave us ratings and review whatever you prefer and whatever you feel comfortable doing it. And I really love hearing back from you. So I just wanted to give a couple of seconds to thank you, everyone who listens and supports this project. It really means a lot to me hearing from you that it helps and inspires you. And I will continue putting out awesome content for you. A lot of cool topics and guests are coming soon. And now, without any further delays, let's dive into the interview is Samantha.
Welcome to our Belly Dance live podcast show. How's it going? Let's start.
Good. This is exciting. Yeah. I love talking about dance. Yeah, and I think you do too. So
a little bit weird to start because we are like for 2 days in Montreal. We already talked with Samantha so about so many topics. So it's like sitting now in her apartment. Yeah. Like, okay, let's do an interview. Anyway, just to start, do you remember how you got involved in belly dance? Like, do you remember the moment that the idea to go to belly dance class appeared in your mind?
Absolutely. Well, I always danced, like, since I'm a child. But also, one of the funny stories, it's not the real story, but is that my mom took belly dancing classes right before she got pregnant with me. And she always told me that. But she also did modern dance, and I had done modern dance. But when I started getting interested in Arabic dance, and she said, oh, that's funny, because right before I was pregnant with you, I was taking belly dance classes in Detroit, which has a huge Arab community. And I always thought, oh, this is your fault, Mom. But actually, I remember the moment that I really got interested to it. And I had seen belly dancers when I was a kid. Like, we went to some restaurants and stuff like that. And I was like, I was always dancing, but didn't really spark my interest at that point. But I was taking another dance class in a studio. I was very interested in African dance. I was really intensively studying West African dance. And there was a class right after of, like, one of a class I was taking at a studio. And I remember thinking, I got to stay and try that class one time. And so a friend of mine, finally we did it. And it just sort of just took off from there. And then we just never stopped. So, and it was just sort of another way of moving, like, immediately that was like, oh, I like this. And the music, and it just clicked, you know? As much as I was loving what I was doing in African dance, which was strength and power, and this was like strength and power, but also fluidity and the melodies, and I just was like, there we go. And I'm still here all these years later. So I remember it very clearly. It wasn't like a day, but it was very clear, uh-huh, a period of my life where it was like, yes.
It's so good. Why did you tell that was not real story about your mom's classes? What was the deal there?
Well, it's funny because she tells me this story, but it was only sort of after I got interested in it. Like, I don't think it affected. I joke like, oh, this is your fault that I heard when you got pregnant with me, like, somehow I've heard the music and it. But of course, I mean, that's, well, I don't know. Maybe that's true, but it was in there somewhere. But
that's okay. Did she ever join you for belly dance classes afterwards?
No. No, that was a short-lived period in her life. But what's funny is because a lot of the friends I was taking belly dance classes with, our moms were of a certain generation also, where it was like sort of, you know, women in the 60s and 70s, and a lot of them had taken belly dance. It was a sort of, I think it was an American and Canadian kind of like a sort of a movement of women's, like, there was a certain discover yourself and a little bit hippie era. And a lot of my mom and her friends, I discovered a lot of my other friends' moms too had taken it. And it, I thought, wow, that's hilarious, you know? And I don't think any became professional, but it was like a trend at a certain time, I think. Yeah. It was funny, so, yeah.
But that would be awesome, like, if... well, they say that it sort of influences what music moms, the future moms listen to.
Yeah, so maybe.
Maybe you're one of the examples of this.
I joke about that, but, yeah.
And later, moving on, because you are now only specializing in folklore. So how was that transition? Because now you don't do belly dance.
No, I've stopped that. I fill in the odd class, like teaching a belly dance class. But I don't perform. I haven't for a few years. And I don't really organize classes of that anymore. Like, I'm not really active in that. But for me, the getting into the more folkloric styles, it, for me, it wasn't so much a transition as coming full circle, because my original interest after I'd seriously studied modern dance was I'd left modern dance to go into, I was sort of searching for other forms of dance that weren't, you know, where there was this connection with the audience that I wasn't finding in more Western modern dance, what they call that third wall, you know, where they're performing. And I had, there wasn't that, that there was a point where I was doing a little bit of flamenco. I did some Indian Kathak dance, and then I got into West African dance. And so I was already more interested in sort of the, I don't want to say ethnic dance, but dances of from different countries around the world. And not so much this Western art dance. I wanted that connection. So at one point, I ended up discovering more, you know, Arabic dance, Egyptian specifically. My first teacher was Egyptian. And Denise and Anne in the Ottawa area, Gatineau area. And I think probably at that point, there was a branch where I was really interested in the culture and the earthy sort of folky styles. And she was a folk, my teacher was a former folkloric dancer of the Komeya troupe from Egypt, who's in Canada now. And then somehow I feel like I got into the more belly dance, like the glitzy, glamoury style, which was never fully my style. And so when I got back into other styles of dance, like after, you know, being more in the more glamorous, blinged out belly dancer world, to me, getting back into my interest of the, I don't want to say the, some of the other cultural styles of other countries around, you know, the MENAT region. And also, it was more of like a coming home to me. So it wasn't like I, it was like a return to what I was always interested in. So it wasn't like, oh, now this is new. It was like actually coming back, just discovering other regions that I was more interested in. And I really wanted to dive into. So for me, it was like a natural full circle, if I want to call it. And also during that whole time, I'd been doing a degree in anthropology with my specific focus, interest was in dance ethnology. So I did a degree in anthropology so I could study dance. And in that time, I'd done different projects on different elements of usually Middle Eastern dance, because that's what my interest was, and North African. So to me, coming back to the more folky dances of the people, I would call them, you know, it was just a natural sort of return to what I was interested in, and more diving into the cultural element. Not that belly dance doesn't have that, but it wasn't, for me, it was never about just the performance and the stage. It was always returning back to the culture. So that was, has always been my main interest. Mm. So it just felt like a total natural. And at just some point, I just got so obsessed that I left more of the oriental dance to the side. It just wasn't, there's so much to discover, and I don't, so it just was a natural thing for me. It wasn't like a new thing. Styles are new. I discovered new styles that I was like, oh my god, I didn't know about this, or new regions and I didn't know and I needed to explore for myself. But for me, it's fairly natural. Like, it's always been what I've done, sort of. Yeah, does that make sense? Yeah
absolutely. But it's interesting, like, it's but I mean, by transition, I mean not exactly like discovering something new or anything like that. I was more thinking like how you got from ballet dance. Like you mentioned that your first teacher was Egyptian style and probably she brought some folklore elements to it. Because I find in different countries there are different styles of teaching. Like, for instance, in Ukraine, when I was studying ballet dance, it was literally like just one class ballet dance. Like there was beginners, intermediate, advanced. Mm-hmm. That's it. And if teacher decides that next semester you are learning Tunisian folklore as your main choreography of the semester, you are doing it.
No, yeah.
Unless you're going and switching studio. In Canada, I don't know in those years, but like now, for instance, I see, and I think it's in many other countries, they have like ballet dance technique level 1, ballet dance technique level like 4, 5, 6, then technique with zills, then folklore, then class with a prop. Right. So it's too many choices, and then people usually, they don't go to folklore class. If they come to ballet dance studio, the general students, they go to ballet dance class or technique or choreography or props. Like folklore is usually one of the last choices they do.
Yeah.
Not always, but usually. Yeah. So I was more curious how, like, because I know we talked just recently that you were really obsessed with ballet dance at some point. So if you can tell a little bit about that time of your life.
Yeah.
And how even being super obsessed and successful as a performer, like you had so many gigs as a ballet dancer, how did it came to the point that now you actually don't do ballet? You're very successful in folklore style, but I think for many dancers, ballet dancers who are obsessed currently with ballet dance, it's like, what do you mean to stop doing ballet dance and just do folklore? So how do this interest in folklore grow, and why you did, like, why wasn't it going together, ballet dance and folklore?
Yeah, and it did, actually. So it's not like one day I stopped, I'm going to stop everything, belly dance and oriental dance and just do this. There was several years where it overlapped, you know? So, and even when I was a belly dancer, I think I did. I loved classical Arabic music, you know, Umm Kulthum and all the Abdel Halim and all this. But I think what people would probably remember me for was more ballady style, my more Saeed. Like I was definitely more of an earthy dancer. It's just how I've been trained as a modern dancer and a West African dancer. I was very earthy. So that was generally natural for me already. But there were many years where it overlapped. So I would start to I started doing my research. I was researching things and I was still doing gigging at some club on Friday night, like totally belly dance. And I think there were many years where it overlapped. And then I think I started to be drawn to other musics too. You know, you go to a club and you're like, what is this kind of music? Like, you know, these hearing different things and then needing to know more about it and then learning more about some style that is like, oh my gosh, you know, because sometimes I knew there was all these other things, but like the Egyptian, Lebanese belly dance world, and especially Egyptian, sometimes we don't get exposed as immediately, depending on who our teachers are and where we are and all these things. You're like, well, this is what it is, you know, but then there's so much more. And so I think moving to this city where I'm in now, Montreal, I started to hear other musics too. And it really piqued my curiosity. And I was like, what is this? These rhythms. There was a lot of North African influence that I was like, wow, this is different. I love this. What are these rhythms? So, you know, exploring, going to clubs, I'm like, this dances, these people are dancing differently. And it was not like Lebanese, which I was used to, for example, because most of the clubs where I'd been in previously. So there were many years where it started to overlap. And I was like, okay, I'm doing my gigs, cabaret, belly dance set. And then I'd be like, okay, well, I'm learning about this. And so there was a lot of years where it overlapped. But then there was a point where, first of all, I didn't want to, I was leaving the performance. I didn't want to perform every weekend and all this whole thing about belly dance. And then it just seemed like my own artistic needs were like, I just need to go deeper into these other things. And it just was like a natural, like one sort of started to dominate and then the other just kind of, you know, and when I sort of stopped oriental dancing more, it wasn't like now only because I was doing folklore. There's other reasons also because it's always, you know,
was like taking up my whole weekends, every, you know, performing after 15 years of performing, you know, a lot of weekends out of your life, and I had no life. And there's a lot of reasons that I slowed down on it. And then it just, so then I started the troupe, of a folklore troupe to really company troupe to start to really be able to dedicate myself to it. And then I just like, I just was like obsessed, and the oriental dance, like as I was, it just sort of took up less space. And and I personally was less inspired by what I was seeing too around me, and the that's, you know, without my own critique of what I was seeing, like going on in the belly dance wars, was less inspiring to me personally as an artist. So I just went in the direction, and I never looked back. But it's not like I would never do oriental dance again. I'm not so interested in performing for myself, but you know, I do love the music, and I love the way it makes my body feel. But yeah, it was just this natural kind of, I'd say it's more of an artistic, you know, journey than like a choice I made to do one over the other. Because you can do both. You can definitely do both. And there were many years I did both. Like I'd do a belly dance gig, and then you'd be like, okay, I'm going to include this, or, you know, or having contracts where you're able to offer different things. And it's just more of a choice to not, to really focus on one. Yeah.
But also one fascinating thing is that you also transitioned mainly in the folklore styles that are not typically taught in ballet and school.
Yeah.
Like, we're not talking here about, like, Egyptian folklore.
Right.
Like, we're talking about Moroccan, Algerian, Iraqi.
Yeah.
Can you add?
Tunisian, a lot of Khaliji. Those are my main styles, and a lot of other exploring, taking classes in. I would take whatever I could find, you know. I was in a church basement with a Debki troupe. I'm taking a class of some Turkish thing that I was just like, I got to discover everything. Yeah. I mean, I specialize, but so those aren't my specialties, but there's so much to know, you know.
And you also put the whole troupe just about those styles, based on those styles, folklore, like not ballet dance troupe, which was also commercially successful because, like, you have requests and gigs. But do you think your interest in those specific styles, or maybe how fast you found those styles, was it anything influenced by the place that you live now, in Montreal, or was it started regardless somewhere before you moved even?
I think it's both, actually. You know, I mean, I think it's a lot of things. Maybe it's a little bit of destiny that I ended up here too. Well, ended up, it's not that far of a leap from where I was before, only 2 hours away. But there's a combination, because I had been studying West African dance and I loved it, you know, and I had also been studying belly dance at that time. So I was studying these two dances, a very Arabic kind of Egyptian belly dance and West African dance. And I went to West Africa a few times and ended up going to Morocco through that time. And there was this point, and being in West Africa, all the countries I were in were more based in Muslim traditions. And so hearing this and having the cultures of mixed, not mixed cultures, but they were heavily dominated by the Arabic influence of Islam and stuff. And I was like, whoa, there's places where these things like kind of cross over, you know? And it piqued my interest. Like, I was like, whoa, these musics are, you know, we want to put things in boxes, like this is this and this, but it's not quite, geography and cultures didn't, they don't stay like that. And I was like, wow, this is fascinating. And that piqued my interest. And then I ended up after that moving to Montreal, where I sort of stumbled into this large population of North African people. And I was like, this is like what, like these rhythms just called to me, this mixture of what I loved about the African nature of, I mean, I'm generalizing about African music, but there's like an essence to it, mixed with the Northern African stuff, which is, can be Berber, can be Arab, can be the tonality of singing. And I was like, this is everything I've been looking for. So it really drew me in. But then, so it's a little bit of destiny, a little bit of all of it together, you know, like, I mean, I had gone into flamenco. It didn't speak to, you know, is mm-hmm. how we choose our artistic path. It's just, it seemed natural for me to go into this, these styles. So most of the folkloric regions I've been most interested in are, have African roots to them, which is the Gulf, like Khaliji too has African. I feel very connected to that part of it, which is maybe some styles I love, but I less connect to them just personally. But that's just been my Canadian girl here who's been like obsessed with African music since I'm like 16 or even younger. But I don't know. It's what it is. So I connected to that part, but it's, yeah. It maybe it's a little bit of destiny. Who knows how these artistic, you know, you... Looking back, I can see that now, but I didn't see the pieces.
They say you can connect dots on the looking backwards.
Yeah, but it makes sense. Yeah, and it feels natural. It doesn't feel like I chose them. It feels like that's where the mm-hmm. you know, life took me. And it was a natural thing, you know.
And how did your learning journey continue? Because you mentioned that first you start Middle Eastern and like North yeah. African folklore with Egyptian, which is very typical for ballet yeah. dancer. But then, like, now you're more into specializing more in, like, Moroccan and Berber and Tunisian. How was your learning process? Like, did you literally got some teacher who inspired you, or you got it from music? I keep hearing you talking again about music, so it kind of gives yeah. me an idea that it's main your inspiration and
yeah.
inspiration to keep learning and discovering. But... because it's not a style that's that easy to go and learn somewhere. No. And especially it's very confusing what is true information and what is not true information. What you find on the internet or mm-hmm. someone told you, like, is it really the thing? Or they just making it yeah. for you? Or someone put random thing on the internet and just called it Moroccan dance?
Yeah, and... to start with the music, for me, all like, I mean, I've been dancing since I'm a kid, and it was always about the music, you know, like that's what drew me in the most. There's lots of great musics in the world too, but you know, some just speak to you like in a way that is just, if I don't love the music, I can't, you know, I just can't. That's my gateway mm-hmm. to it. It's not the costumes. It's not the stage. It's not performing. It's the music. Like, that's, you know, so that's the big thing for me. But the learning is difficult because there are so most of my learning, like it happened a little bit by accident. So most of my learning in these styles was not through the dance world, like mm. belly dance school or classes. I had the odd workshop, you know, some teacher would be visiting who knew about something, some folkloric style, but it happened by a little bit by accident. And I'd say 95% of all my teachers that I say teachers in the sense of anybody who taught me, were not from the oriental dance community. They were, so like the first experience was like a friend who said, oh, I'm dancing in this troupe, like, you know, this Quebecois girl. And she said, oh, it's an Algerian troupe. Do you want to join? I was like, okay. Like, I don't really know what that's about, you know? And it's like me and her and a bunch of, you know, everybody else is Algerian. And then that happened to me twice. Mm-hmm. Another group, which was just Berber Algerian. And these people were not in the dancey world. Like, they were just dancing within the communities. They weren't in the belly dance school. And through that, there were other teachers that appeared. Like, people who were former artists, for example, who now live here. You know, one guy who led that first troupe was a former folkloric dancer of a certain Algerian style in his region. So, okay, you know, but they're not people anybody would ever know, like, mm-hmm. Because in the dance world, there's very, very few teachers of these styles. Thank God there's a few more now, but even then, it's so limited. And if you don't happen to be in those places, it's hard to, you know, really study. So most of it's been through that, like, learning. And it is hard to know. You have to do a lot of research. That's the anthropology part coming in, the research part.
How, by the way, can you give dancers some tips on how to, like, filter information?
Yeah.
Like, how to, what to do, I don't know, what questions to ask in your mind, like, to
yeah.
sort of, like, get a tip, like, is this information what I see or hear, is it really true or not? Like, any tips on how to, because it's very difficult for people, especially not used to analyzing or not having, like, any anthropology background. Like, okay, how do I know? I like this teacher. I like how she dances. She comes to my city, gives me workshops, and everyone else. If she says this, I believe her. So how to sort of filter and not going into criticizing teacher, because that's a different topic, but how to, to filter the information.
It's hard. It's definitely hard. But one thing I think that's helped me, and it has to do with school, but like when we're in university, when you read an article, for example, or a book, they tell you you should always be thinking critically of, like, who is writing this, for who, for what audience are they writing it? Are they being funded? You know, what's their background? What's their goal? What's their, you're sort of not just taking what they wrote. You're talking about who are, you know, all these questions about why did they write this book? Why, who is it, you know? And so, and it's hard because when you don't have a lot of teachers to compare to, you're just watching videos or you're trying to learn, it's hard. And it's not to judge the artist or the person, but to know their background, like, it's a difficult thing. And to talk about artists, let alone people, like, not every, if you ask me questions about the cultural dances of my background, I probably couldn't tell you, like, that much. So it's not like I'm a representative. But if we talk, or, you know, anybody else from any culture, if they're artists and they've maybe studied it or worked in it a little bit, well, maybe they have different answers. But what's their background? For example, I had a chance to work with 3 Algerian troops, okay? One was, like I said, a former dancer, but he was a male. So, of course, he's teaching us these female styles. So it's already, you're like, okay, what's going on here? And that's fine. And there's so many styles in that country. Not all of them are his real, like, he knows. He didn't grow up with all of them, even though maybe they're from his country, but Algeria is the biggest country in Africa. Like, you can't know all the styles. And some styles are very unique to one region. So, okay, so I'm, you know, that's fine. I didn't know. And the second troop I was in with, strictly Berber. So 2 sisters who were Kabyle, from the Kabyle region. So they only did styles they knew. But they also did a bit of fusion because they were young and they wanted to make it look cool. And they said that. So I was like, okay, I can't, what they're doing, for example, this and such and such movement, I could tell that, how could I tell though, that, you know, that these arms were a little bit modern, or, you know, like, so you kind of had to place it, you know, but that, how do you know? I didn't know until later when I was like, oh, that what they were doing is a little bit fusion, you know, but it's also sometimes looking back. The third troupe I danced with was with former dancers of the National Algerian Ballet, they call it. So the state troupe, who now live in Montreal. So they were teaching us dances and they were all, like, classically trained dancers. So their style, I knew these styles. Now I had to add experience and I knew styles. First of all, their styles were so classically, it was sort of like, not Reda troupe style, but, you know, like the carriage of their posture and the way it was very different than the women I'd seen dancing, you know, from those same styles. And I was like, whoa, but their posture was very different. It was very choreographed. It wasn't a natural dance. They'd all learned it. So these were people who'd come from all over Algeria who'd be classically trained in the city. So their background, obviously, but by that time I could sort of compare, and it's hard when you don't have a lot of teachers to compare, which is where videos help too. So are they in a national troupe? Well, then that's one thing. That's a background. If they're teaching you, they're teaching you from their background as a national troupe member who learned, they most likely have ballet, like, experience in it, or structure, or are you going to a party, like in some cultural festival, and you're watching women dance, or men who are untrained? Like, what are people's intentions on and what you're watching or seeing, or they're teaching you? There's no judgment. It's all good and it's all correct ish but they're only teaching you what they know, right? So, and that's fine. Like, I mean, I could tell you something about, you know, something, but that would be from my perspective. But
So you kind of have to filter it and not, I don't mean not take anybody's word for cash, because you can't be like, oh, is that true? But you go, okay, that's this person's perspective. And sometimes we don't have a lot of comparison, but even with like video, like YouTube's such a great resource, you can watch and if possible, read the comments. And if possible, go, okay, this looks like a wedding. This looks like a troop, or is this in a village? Or is this like, what is the context that's going on? Try and like, not just look at the moves they're doing, but like the, you know, is this a stage formed version of this dance? Is this look like a wedding party? Do these look like professional dancers? Like, we can't always read the comments. If you can, you can learn a lot. What people are saying about them. So that's usually where we fail, because we can't always read the comments. But I think it's just really like, and it's all correct in a sense, unless it's false, like totally false information. But to sort of place it in a, if you can, if that makes any sense. It's really difficult though. And usually it's only with experience, right? Because if we don't have a ton of teachers in the community, so you're having in the dance community, so if you take one workshop and you never get another in that style, then you're likely to think that's exactly what it is, like, because you don't know. And it's normal. It's not, it's, that's difficult. That can be difficult. I think it's just a lot of experience and watching. Like, if you've seen 30 videos on YouTube of this style of dance and they all do these arms, and then you see one and they're doing some sort of like fusion-y arms things, they might be the one that you just have to kind of also pick out what is really, really common. There's certain things like patterns, and I mean, that's a generalization, but sometimes you can pick up things like, okay, this look, you know what I mean? Like,
but also on this note, I just want to add, like, it's really cool to analyze the patterns, but also analyze which performances you're watching for, you're looking at, because there can be mistakes repeated as patterns if you're talking about stage performances by dancers who are not part of that culture. So if you're watching the videos from, like, I don't know, village or local wedding that is part of this culture, and there are repeated patterns, I like, that's absolutely amazing way of learning and sort of filtering, oh, probably that's part of the dance. But there, we know there are so many misconceptions. So my other questions, still being active in ballet dance world, not as a ballet dancer, but being a part of it and in like looking at the scene, which most common misconceptions from ballet dancers you see regarding any folklore or some folklore that you are more specialized, whichever you want to like highlight one or two, which you see repeatedly the most common mistakes or changes or misconceptions in the dancers, ballet dancers' interpretations of certain folklore styles?
No, that's that. Do I dare?
I mean, from your point of view, from your knowledge, like, we are not, again, we talk about thinking critically, so don't even take our words.
and of course, this is, again, like, even me as a speaker or as if I teach, like, I'm speaking from my experience. One of the things, just returning to the idea of the videos, is yes, or the teacher, like, obviously, I mean, to say obviously, but maybe not, like, to watch as many original videos or performances, if possible, live or teachers of the source is the beginning. That's the beginning. Then after, if you watch dancers from wherever else, any other country, you will see where they've made adaptations. Because if you get familiar with the original style in all its versions, whether it's, you know, ballet or renda style, whatever, you'll see, then you can judge. Which is sometimes a little harder to do research in, especially certain styles. It depends when we, but go, like, as much as possible, go to the source to begin with, and always to go back to. That's the live, if you can, or if not, on video. And it's hard because language and cultural things about videos, it's not always easy, but that's definitely a big source. As for any style of dance in the world, I mean, that's that seems like, that seems like a given, but I think it's not, actually. The misconceptions, oh gosh. I wouldn't call it a misconception, but I think that So in the regions I'm more interested in and have more experience in, is that the belly dance world, the dancer world, is very fascinated by certain styles. Things that are wild. Things where women are like raw, wild, or have a certain attitude, which are, let me name some, Iraqi. But Iraqi, this kaulia hair, which is one thing. If we talk about North Africa, I think dancers who don't know much, you know, if you know anything, the only ones you might have heard of are either the Shehat from Morocco, who also have this raw, wild energy, you know, hair rolling, can somersaults and all sorts of stuff. And the dancers who verge on stories of, I don't know what the word would be, like the Ouled Nile, who have this legend around them about prostitution, and but they were in control. This whole legend that is not is true and untrue, but dancers love that. So, but which is slightly a shame because there's all these magical styles that are not fascinating to the dancer world, but are sublime styles, but they won't catch the attention because they're not, they don't have that, some story around them of this something which to the people of those countries is what they're actually dancing. Women in Morocco are not dancing shehat. They're dancing other styles, many other styles. Women in Algeria don't dance like the Ouled Nile. They might be dancing Nile style, but they're so like, so it's sort of this disconnect, which is, you know, in Iraq, I mean, there's this whole thing about the that one style that has become so popular, which Iraqi people can be very, some like it, some don't. So it's like this whole thing, but dancers, it's like, that's it. And then we call it Iraqi style, or I've done that too, because you're trying to talk to people who don't know a Moroccan dance, but it's shehat. Mm-hmm. People love shehat, they hate shehat. So it's just a shame that some people, like, it gets focused on those ones get attention and others get no attention, but they are, they're real, like, really deep in the folklore, but they don't get the attention from dancers. Mm. They're not so stage appreciated or...
Do you think belly dance absorbs and welcomes more easily styles that can be easily transformed into a show?
Definitely. And there are styles, I'm granted, some folklore styles where... Like, they're repetitive and
I really liked your story that you recently mentioned why you are so resistant to put your troupe in a competition, yeah. Folklore, and what your was idea, yeah. Which style to choose. Can you tell it?
Well, because first of all, like, yeah, that's interesting because many of the styles we were working in is mostly North African, some other styles, which are not these highly polished styles. We don't want to make our arms exactly all like the same angle and our, you know, there's an organicness to us and we dance mostly for people within those communities here in Montreal or elsewhere. And we don't need to polish it in the way that we would need to polish it and adapt it for a competition, and then to be judged on it because our, you know, our angle of our, something's off or that it would seem like a criticism that I would, is irrelevant to me. Whereas we go and perform for, I don't know, some event and the Moroccan people, like I'd say for Moroccan, I wouldn't want to, they're like, it's going well and they're not saying, oh, do you know your foot? Like, so it's, yes, we try our best to do all our good work, but I don't think that the evaluation is the same. And so, mm-hmm. And one is relevant to me and the other, I don't want to have to do those adaptations. And to make it like, oh, well, we better throw in some hair because that will make us get us points. Like when it's, is it the style or choose styles that are like, yeah. And the judges don't always know how to judge it either. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. Like I was mentioning, it's fun to have folklore, but if you don't have judges in a competition, but if you don't have judges who have any clue, like I was mentioning certain local competitions where some of the dancers did styles that, like, And judge's response was, I don't know this style, so I can't judge it. But then what are you doing judging? Like, what's the point? Like, so it's frustrating. So if you're doing not like Saidi or maybe some of the more common styles that, yeah, we expect that, then, you know, and then to be judged on things that aren't really relevant. So I was saying, oh, yeah, we should do a number that's so folkloric where, you know, you just stand in a line and just like do this little shoulder movement, and because that's the dance. But it would be like so not, you know, it's not impressive. It's not, it isn't the goal. It's not stage fantastic. It's just very, you know, like most, a lot of very folkloric dances are based around community and moments of celebration or different markings of life passages or different elements of cultural societal life for those people. They're not meant to be necessarily presented. They can be very repetitive based on certain things that we might not see, the codes or relevance. Mm-hmm. So to present something so like on the opposite end and then like, okay, judge us. Go ahead, judge us. That's just being kind of like my rebellious side to be like, come on. But, you know, that obviously that's not interesting, but it's just sort of like, it's a hard thing to have that category in a competition. It doesn't interest me in the least. Even belly dance for me is less interesting in a competition, but I can understand why people would do it. But the folklore category, it's really hard. It's really difficult.
Do you think once dance is put on stage, can it be truly be called folklore?
Good question, Sienna. I could ask all of you all these same questions and get your answers.
Well, we are interested in your opinion in this episode.
Yes, because I also think there's many levels to the stage. So I was very much inspired by Sarah Saida, or Sarah Kent, whichever name she prefers to go by now, with her Journey Through Egypt program. And how she broke it down, love her, as an anthropologist, as a dancer, she's just, like, number one. And anybody who should can take that, any of her classes should take it. So how she broke it down from very, like, village to, like, you know, even local communities, village people, that sounds wrong, but, like, have, at some point, there are people who are better musicians or better performers and, you know, yes, they're community dances, but sometimes there are very local troupes that happen and then, you know, and then maybe more regional troupes and all the levels of stageification, if I can say that, up until national troupes who are touring the world with their different intentions to present their dances to, you know, a world audience. So I think that the degree of staginess is difficult. It changes. So, of course, the national troops, although they're beautiful, they are many degrees away, if I can say, from the original source. Not to say they're less good, but, yeah, I mean, the degrees of, like, away from the real folklore. And are we, is our goal to present real, authentic folklore? How can we do that? I mean, I'm not sure I can do that. I'm this Canadian woman. Like, who am I to present this authentic? It's totally out of context already. I don't know. I'm not naming any specific styles, but like, how can we present a true, authentic? What does that mean? That's a word. But so is that my goal? How far do I want to be from authentic? What choices am I making? How many degrees away from, like, I guess those are choices to make, you know, like, what music are you using? What's your goal in this? Are you in this is an interesting thing. We performed in Dubai with my group, a few years ago. And, they had pavilions from all over the world, these different cultural pavilions, mostly from the Middle East, North Africa, but some others. And a lot of them had folkloric presentations. So you had troops that were, it was on stage. I mean, a stage, a platform raised above people. So it was like a stage. It wasn't like a
you know, a national theater stage. And some of the troops, I say that with my, you know, little quotation marks, like there was a troop from Yemen. And I mean, they did like, every group had like 20 minutes. So their thing was like, it was not stageified, let's call it. I mean, they had like some musicians and they did like this repetitive thing, you know, no sort of, I don't know how stageified it was because I'm not that familiar with Yemeni dance, but there was no, there was not a lot of variation. There wasn't like a big choreography. They didn't sort of express much. It seemed very much like a very traditional kind of dance. Then you had groups like different degrees. Then you had like the Lebanese Dabki troupe, which is much more choreographed and theatrical and stageified, and that was ready for stage. Then you had some other Dabki groups, like a Palestinian group that was way more earthy, kind of. It was stageified, but the Lebanese one was extremely theatrical, for example. They were both doing Dabki, but very different degrees of. And then you had the Egyptian group who was, you know, basing it themselves on what's happening in Egypt, so very choreographed. And then you had some other groups, like a Saudi group. It was like a hot, I mean, I don't want to say a hot mess, but it was totally chaotic. It wasn't organized. It was just like, okay, guys, you have to do this on stage. It was not so, they were all folklore, you know, mm-hmm. and all valid, just very different experiences of like, what the folklore is. But I mean, that's based on all sorts of factors, like of the countries, you know, Egypt has a big history on examples of these two state national companies, you know, Dabki is very much performed. I don't know what's happening in Yemen. I'm not that familiar, but it didn't seem like they had a lot of, you know, the other groups were not, there was not like a very much of a stageified thing. I loved it. It was super traditional. The local Emirati group was, looked like they had organized it enough to perform in local cultural events, you know, which is one more real than the other. I don't know. Like, I'm not sure, you know, like, is that a, I mean, some looked more traditional. Some looked clearly stageified and the costumes were more like sparkly and,
I guess I should have formed my question differently. Not that if folklore can be truly called folklore, what's in the stage, but if folklore can be called authentic, truly authentic, if it's put on stage. So I probably worded it slightly different, but that's exactly what you just said. Yeah. Like it's very difficult to put any folklore without any polishing, any changes on stage and make it not lose its essence and also make people actually watch the full performance with enthusiasm. Because I find a lot of folklore styles, of course, like not all possibly folklore styles around the world, but a lot of folklore styles, they are based on the moment of some emotions expressed via dance, usually some celebrations and happiness. Mm-hmm. And there is no clear separation between performer and audience. Everyone is a part of performance. Everyone is a part of audience at the same time. Then it's truly folklore. But once we put it on stage, we do the separation. And then we do need to do some changes just naturally to make it work. Because it's not improvisation. It's not like I feel joy in a moment and I'm on stage. I may be sad by whatever reason happened like 5 minutes ago. I had to go on stage, but I have to go and dance. So it's not authentic in terms like of my expression of emotions that usually comes in folklore dance. Like it's in the moment. But then there is a line to which extent we can change it. So it still stays folklore and it transforms into something else, like our fantasy.
And that's, I think, where the talent or the experience comes, or the knowledge to know which choices are to make. I mean, if you're making a dance to present, for like you said, you have to make some choices, like, but which choices work and which take it too far away from its essence or something, you know, whether it's costuming, choreography, music, I think that's the key element. Like, it's not that you can't do something modern or innovative or new, you know, like, or on a big stage, but how to make those choices, that's, I mean, I think there's some things we see sometimes where we go, okay, that decision maybe was either was made out of a wrong, like, we all make not always the right decision. Sometimes you do it by experience. You go, okay, that move is really taking, like, it's not working, you know, or, mm-hmm. or out of ignorance to think, well, we'll just add in a turn here. That's not always, we can't just plop in like this filler of like adding in stuff. That's a dangerous line, I guess. That's hard. I think that's the hardest part, like, to know what to do. Mm-hmm. And you don't always know. I personally, like, as I was talking, I used to do the modern dance, and I got tired of that third wall, like you say, that, and the more, like, traditional folklores are, there is no, there's very little separation of, you know, it's community, it's kids, it's grandma, it's the musician sitting right there, or whatever. I mean, I'm generally speaking. And then some are, like, a little more presented, you know, by certain groups of musicians who are, you know, a little more talented or whatever. But I know for myself, in my own experience, like, as in oriental dance or folklore, like, the bigger the stage and the higher the stage away from the people, the less I'm comfortable and the less it works. Because it's not about the visual, like, of just, like, taking space or doing line, like, the styles are meant to be closer to people. So it usually goes much worse, like, on a bigger stage where, you know, like, a more theatrical stage. Like, I don't enjoy that as much. I've done it. But I love, for example, like, a, you know, a low-rise stage, like in a folk festival where you may be at a small stage, but you're very close to the people, or you're somehow in a... That works much, much better. That's been my experience, and that's my taste, mm-hmm. you know, because they're not meant to be just visual pictures. The more I lose that connection with the people, and whether or not there are people, like, who are understanding the dance, informed, or just whoever, like, non-informed people, it always goes better the closer we are to the people. Mm-hmm. And also in a group, it's much better. Solo, taking some of the styles into solo styles is always... Like, a little bit, not always, it depends on the style, but generally, if we're talking about community dances that are generally based in community or identity, and you're dancing in a group, it's generally gonna feel more of that feeling, even if, you know, you're not of that culture, but, like, you're just gonna hopefully grab that feeling rather than being a solo dancer. That's hard. That's like, you're just, like, far out of context. So for me, that's been my experience. I don't enjoy those shows near as much because people are just watching. They're not, yeah, there's not that engagement of, you know, energy, and it's not necessarily about how it's supposed to be looking, you know, the visual, like, picture of the exterior. It's, yeah. Mm. So I guess that maybe, I mean, the folklore is from the folk, from the people. So the farther you get away from the people, whoever those people are, yeah, then I guess you're losing a little bit of it. Maybe it's a question. It's not a declaration of truth, but the more you get away from the essence of the people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's one of those, like, topics that, yeah. I don't know if we can find the truth here. It's more just about sharing experiences and just keep discussion, yeah. and critical thinking about these things.
Yeah.
Because coming back, like, a full circle to what we were talking in the beginning, like, in ballet dance world, it's often what becomes popular as a folklore is those stuff that can be easily transformed into the show.
Yeah.
But then the question is, like, but is it still a folklore if it's so much got transformed into the show? And it's like, yes and no at the same time, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. And I do think in the West, like, there's a judgment that somehow what is on stage is more, that's art. And what's from the people is like, that's not art with a capital A. Like, it's, that's folky. I do think there's a value judgment placed on that. Maybe less today. And I think that's across all arts, like, you know, generally speaking, like craft is not as valued as what's hanging in a museum. This idea of what's high art and what we call lower art. And I mean, that's, I've faced that a lot throughout my artistic journey as a dancer and also as a person working with my hands in visual and craft art. Why are some people artisans, craftspeople rather than artists? You know, this idea of like, there is a judgment call, I think, that gets placed on dances that are originally not in that system of like that, you know, like we're placing a judgment on things that I see that a little bit, for example, with the Persian dance, that this classical, more elegant, somehow, oh, that's lovely. Whereas, and I'm not so familiar with the Persian dance as you are, but, or for example, that's lovely, that's elegant, that's stagey.
That can't represent the
country. Yeah, whereas, you know, there's lots of other dances that are far more earthy and less it seems like it gets a higher status. For example, that style, or I don't know. Like there could be other examples.
Yeah, we even
had
the discussion about all, literally, like there is a book right about the past, about like national troops of different countries and how even in every country, either it's Egypt or Mexico or Russia, they still choose which folk dances to include in their repertoire.
Yeah.
To give a certain representation. But also coming back just to what you were saying, I also got the idea that in ballet dance world or in the dance world, we like to judge also and like give assumptions and like our, what is wrong and what is not wrong. And, like one way of discussion is like, oh, this is too much, like, it should be this done way or another that way. But also we also very often go in opposite direction in criticizing changes too much. And this is overgeneralizing, but even I am guilty. I'm like of that thinking sometimes, because one of the examples, like it comes more on the discussion of ballet dance on my mind right now, but I think you can add something similar probably from folkloric styles. But one of the discussions like, oh, ballet dance should not be done with the props, this crazy, like, I don't know, flags, poi, wings. It's not a part of authentic ballet dance. But then you go in Lebanese club and Lebanese or Arab people, they love seeing those shows. Like if you go like to any restaurant in Dubai, dancers, they're not dancing just Kalsum or like things. No, they're actually creating a show, and for local people who are part of that culture that they are presenting in their dance. But then as dancers, as like ballet dancers, I kind of feel there is a lot of distance between what's we perceive as a ballet dance or dance world in general, what's supposed to happen and not happen, and what's actually happening in real world where ballet dance is a part of day-to-day culture for people.
There's this thing like, well, can it be authentic? But if it's not, how can I explain it? I understand what you mean. We will judge if it's too far, like, but maybe that's our own judgment. Like, I agree, because, and some people, we want to put things in categories. We love that, you know, like, so this is belly dance and this is folklore and this is, but it's not like people, you were talking about that a little bit earlier in the workshops, and I was thinking about another dancer we were talking about, recently, and you know, how people sometimes, as an artist or an entertainer, the style, you know, and how people in the communities are dancing, it's not like, they're not separate categories necessarily. Like people might do a mix because that's what's popular. Like, so another artist drew this attention to my attention more recently, and it made me think more like about Moroccan dance and how, okay, well, Moroccan dance, and that's Moroccan dance already is like a word, that there's so many kinds, but is not oriental dance. But it doesn't mean that Moroccan people don't do oriental dance and that you go to a party and people aren't dancing a little bit of both or maybe from this region or, you know, it's not like, they're not the same, but they're not separate. The culture is, you know, so there's a dancer right now, her name's Maya. She's very popular and she does a combination and it works and she's like really popular and she's getting asked to do all these shows within the communities all over Morocco, France. She came to Canada recently. People love her and she does it. But if I did that, I would probably get blasted, right? Because, well, you can't mix it and no, this is this and this is this. I would likely get blasted. But she's doing it because that's her, that's what she does. And people aren't like, oh my God, like people grow up with all those musics. Okay, I mean, you can choose to like one more than the other or whatever, but they're not the same, but they're not separate either. They're not like, that's an example. But yeah, we can judge it like, well, that if a dancer did that in the dance community, would probably get like ripped apart, you know, for not knowing what they were doing. But maybe that's exactly what they were doing. We don't know. But like, I'm not sure if that's the best example, but I get what you mean because it's like this trying to be, are we trying to be really authentic? But then we can also be judged for being too
judgy.
like, you know, or you get a clip of a video like of somebody doing something that was in the moment very appropriate for that moment, but like, oh my God, that can't be done, and all this
taken out of context, it can be not appropriate,
you know. And it's, and we have these rules, what is the Iraqi dancer supposed to be wearing? They wear all sorts of stuff, like Melain wears belly dance costumes, she also wears dresses, she also, we see other videos and they're wearing this, and but yet it's this like, there's a lot of judgment of what is true, what's not true. And again, we should probably not want to be categorizing everything and judging and always referring back to the culture. And I know it's hard because we don't always have the references, but it's not quite so clear. Like, mm-hmm. And are there these rules? Okay, me as a Canadian, like I'm a Canadian, like North America, you know, I'm going to be careful about what I present to an event because that's my job. I have a job to be professional as myself as an artist. I have a responsibility if I'm presenting a cultural dance to do my best. I'm not going to start doing like whatever I want, mm-hmm. whenever I want. There's times for that. And there's times for representing as best I can the culture that I've had the gift to be learning about. I have a job to do for that. So I feel a big responsibility. Are there adaptations? Yeah. Are there times where it's more than others? Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. You do your best. And there's times maybe you go further. I guess it really depends on context. But we're good at judging, I'd say. But yeah. That's a complicated topic without getting in big trouble from somebody.
Well, it's a topic to inspire people to think.
Yeah.
And to both think critically if what you receive and think is true statement. And as well, if you don't agree and don't judge, are you really sure you know what you're talking about? And like, what's the context? And like, do you have enough supporting material or enough knowledge or enough experience or enough expertise in general, or even the right to like put any judgment?
Yeah.
I mean, it depends really on the subject. Of course, there are some situations that it's definitely like, this is definitely like, out of any borders.
But, yeah.
But at the same time, like almost any topic can be discussed both ways, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I do know, like, and I agree, like, it's not black and white. I can only speak for me, like, so what I would do, because I'm a guest, I guess, maybe a guest wouldn't be the word. I've had the fortune to have been able to learn about certain dances from people that generously shared and be invited into events, and I do feel I have to do the best I can to respect that.
Absolutely.
It's not like mine to, I feel I have a little bit of a, you know, I have a finer line to walk on than if somebody wants to express their own culture in their own way, then that's their thing. And I do want to be as respectful as I can, you know, and it doesn't mean I can't be creative and artistic and make adaptations, but so there, I do feel like that's my place. It's not my place to necessarily be the innovations or any creativity I want to. I do. It depends on the context also. It also depends. Like if you're a dancer, let's say, who's your audience? I don't mean you can do anything if nobody knows. You shouldn't do whatever you want. But like my experience has been dancing for people of the community. So there's different levels of adaptations that are going to go on with that. Then I'm not, but it's not because there's nobody in my audience that doesn't know about this style. They're like, oh, I'll just do that and they won't know. That's kind of lazy. And sometimes we do something not out of, laziness is probably not the best reason, or not knowing. You know, we have access to research on certain levels. So there's some things we can't know about without experience, but there's some things that it can be corrected mm-hmm. with easy research. So that's a bit lazy. And everything, but you know, I don't want to like. We've all done it. It's not like I'm some like saint that's never, you know, winged it before. But it depends. Like if when I performed with my troupe in a cultural festival, we're asked to be doing a cultural representation. So that's a context. If you're in a party, a wedding party, and it's a mixed event, and they're asking you for mixes, that's probably a place where people are celebrating. It's maybe a different kind of context than, or a private engagement. That's like, yeah, I mean, there's a time and place for everything to also to be more or less creative. I think, you know, but this is people's culture, and I would want somebody to treat my culture with that the same respect that, you know, it's just a natural thing, but. And it's not about this thing about cultural appropriation. It's not this thing, but it's just knowing what are you doing? Like, you know, and the power you have when you are doing that. Like, that's a big job. I take it seriously. And I hope that comes across. But it's not that you can't do anything creative. It's a big topic, though. But, I mean, I'm sure you know if you are invited to an event within the Persian community and they want this. You know which times you can maybe play with it or not, and you feel it. It's not all about you as a performer. Yes, it's about you, but it's about that moment. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a bigger picture. It's not just about me, Samantha, or you, Iana, or there's a moment, and you're part of it, and you're the master of ceremonies for that moment. Those, you know, but you're kind of orchestrating it. But I think we have to think bigger than, you know. That's my opinion, but it's a big topic.
I love how you pointed, like, it's not only about you as a performer. It's about many other things that led you to perform it, that led this dance to exist, and all little consequences of your presentation at this moment. So you are like one little mm-hmm. moment and part in the bigger thing, and... it's really a big topic, and it's more like philosophical discussion topic.
Yeah.
Which I don't even know, like, as you said, it's not black and white. It's somewhere in between.
Yeah.
And it really, but it's interesting to discuss and think about it.
It's fascinating. And whether or not you're doing like a pure let's say a folkloric number on its own or set, or you're including it within like a normal oriental, like, you know, whatever it is you're working on. I mean, there's a lot to consider when you're doing it. But the main thing is that it's fascinating. It's amazing when you start to discover, I mean, beyond all the shows, and that's like the job part where you have to, like, you have a job to do in your work and your artistic work and your integrity, if I can call it that. Cultural work, or whatever levels you want to take it to. I mean, the main thing is it's like there's just so much to know.
And I mean, we can't be experts at all of these styles, obviously. They'll be like, but I think already if you love it, if you find some style that is like calling you and you're like, wow, you want to be able to do it justice the most you can, like, and whatever that means, you know, not for performance, not for money, not for celebrity or whatever, fame and fortune, because it's amazing in its own right. Like, and it doesn't need the belly dance world approval to exist. It exists because it exists within whatever culture, you know, community. If you love it, you'd want to do the best you can in a modern way, in a traditional way, whatever the way it is. But I mean, there's just, that's just, I don't know. That's my passion, Dougie.
That's a nice way to put it. Well, I kind of feel we can talk and talk and talk. We keep talking for all these 2 days.
And it's like philosophical, like, about folklore, yeah.
We can do 2 parts interview.
Well, it's a big topic. And yeah. and what sadly is that in the dance world, it seems like it sometimes is like an extra. Like, okay, I have my oriental, like I have my thing, and then I'll learn some extra things and it's great. But it is nice to have it appreciated on its own, like for what it is, like not just an extra thing. And we don't all have time and interest, I know, to dive into everything. But it's not extra for people like whose culture, like it's much more than that. And it's great to know a little bit about a lot of things. That's very useful, but there's a lot to know. Then you and I have different regions of interest, but I think we share a certain like value, common thinking, about it. So, and I really enjoyed your workshops today. By Iana, great work.
Side comment. Thanks for putting it. Well, before we sum up our interview, can you tell us people where they can find your work, where to follow you? Do you have social media, website, or any places where they can find more about what you do?
Sure. So, yes. So, usually most of my work, other goes under my own name or under the name of my dance company, Sana Dance, S-A-N-A-A, Dance, and we're on Facebook and all that. And usually a lot of the work goes through there, and on the website as well, Sana Folklore. And that's pretty much it, yeah. I'm just doing my thing in my own little bubble here in Montreal.
I also know that you teach classes via Skype.
Yeah, I do. I do travel sometimes to teach in different places, and online too. It's a little harder, but yeah, I do. I'm new to that, but I'm getting into it, and and I love like talking and dancing and sharing what I know anyways, and yeah.
And so for which styles dancers can reach out to you to take some classes, like we mentioned, Moroccan, Algerian, yeah. Tunisian?
Those are 3 countries that I have a lot of more experience in, and only certain styles, so that's because they're big countries. So I do several Moroccan styles, several Algerian styles, a lot of Tunisian, a lot of Khaliji, some Iraqi, and some other, you know, Egyptian styles and this, but mostly I would say that. Mm-hmm. And those are my regions of interest that I know the most about and are most passionate about. Particularly certain styles within that, there's a lot of styles, so it's a little hard to, like, I don't know all the styles, but yes. The North Africa is definitely my, in French we say coup de cœur, my
passion,
the place that hits me the hardest. But so I know what I know, and I'm happy to share it if I can.
That's awesome.
From my experience and perspective.
That's awesome. As always, I'll put all links to show notes to your social media and to your troupe, so people can easily find and contact. And I always ask at the end the same question, like I will adapt it a little bit so it goes beyond ballet dance. So we'll talk more about North African. I'll put together Middle Eastern and North African. So the question is, what makes you fall in love with Middle Eastern and North African dances that you keep doing them again and again, day after day for many years?
Easy answer, music. It's always been the music, and it's the only, not the only thing, but it's the music that draws me in. Like, that's number one. I love the movement, how it feels and how the movement fits with the music, and of course, traditional costuming and dress and adornment, and I won't say costuming. Taking that word out of my repertoire right now. But it's music, 100%. It's always been the music. If I don't feel the music, that's it. It's just the music. It's easy.
Guys, thank you so much for spending this time with us. And if you like this episode, it will mean a world to me if you take a few seconds and leave us a review on iTunes or share it with your friends. Also, you can always find more information about podcast as well as past episodes at janadance.com/podcast. As well as you can connect with me on social media by Iana Dance or Iana Komarnytska. I'm very active on Instagram as well as Facebook and share a lot of tips and inspiration for your daily ballet dance life. And by the way, don't forget to subscribe to podcast so you never miss a future episode. And until next time, keep shimmying.